episode 1944, My Strength is My Story with Angela Braniff, Love Without Borders.
Moms, needing a little inspiration and a ray of hope? You've come to the right place. This is the show that you can turn to for just the pick-me-up you need. This is Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie. Here's your host, certified life coach, personal trainer, and nutritionist, Christiane Wargo. Staring at a
stop sign, watching. Happy, happy day. Today is my favorite day of the week. It is my Strength is My Story series, and we have with us, as some would say, a YouTube star, but others would call her a child of God. It is Angela Braniff, and I'm telling you, your heart is going to be warmed. And if you're wanting to know about bold faith, stay tuned. For those of you who are brand new to Create Your Now, friends and family of Angela's, welcome to our family. I'm so delighted of your presence. If you already had the opportunity, you want to head on over to createyournow.com, where you can learn more and sign up for the Kisses newsletter, the Keep It Simple Strategy, Everyday Solutions to Live Love and Impact. This episode is brought to you by the AIM Academy. Well, Angela shares her story of how God opened up her heart to motherhood, both in the natural and through adoption. She had to embrace the unexpected as he opened the doors and had to be willing to walk in bold faith. You see, Angela gives the most vulnerable children a voice. You know, have you ever wondered where God is? Well, God shows up in the little mundane moments. It doesn't have to be these strikes of lightning or these miracle moments, but it's the mundane ones. If you are questioning where God is, Angela is going to give you hope today, and it's going to renew your bold faith and remind you that He is present. Without further ado, let's welcome in Angela Braniff, Love Without Borders. Hello and welcome to Create Your Now. I'm so excited. We have a YouTube woman. She is on the verge of greatness. You are going to love her. Angela Braniff is a wife of 15 years to her high school sweetheart, CR, and mom to their 8 beautiful children, ages 12 to newborn, and there's a set of twins in there. Angela is the founder of the popular YouTube channel, This Gathered Nest, with 500,000 subscribers. She's an adoption advocate, homeschool mom, content creator, podcast host, and adventure seeker. Angela's newest adventure, though, is becoming an author, where she debuts her brand new book, Love Without Borders, How Bold Faith Opens the Door to Embracing the Unexpected. Buckle up, because Angela is going to take us for a ride. Welcome, my friend and sister in Christ. How are you?
I'm so good. Thank you for that wonderful introduction. You made me sound so much cooler than I actually am. I appreciate that.
Well, you are cool. And I think when I watched one of your YouTube videos, recent ones that you had out, you're like, I'm old at this. Like, I'm old school. I'm old. We didn't have this technology way back when. But you do such a great job. You just have this connection with your audience.
Well, thank you. Yeah, I definitely, it's kind of a weird sort of sphere to be in, because it really is, the demographic there is so much younger as far as content creators go. That's very much like a young person's job. And so I do always joke that I kind of feel like an old lady there, because, you know, most of my sort of work peers, if you will, are in their early 20s. So I definitely kind of feel like, ooh, the youngins, you know, I barely can keep up with what's cool, you know, and what's trendy and the technology changes and stuff like that. So it's an interesting work atmosphere for me to be in.
Well, I know you bring great wisdom to those young ones, so they need to be listening to you so then they can expand a little bit better and increase their wisdom.
That's sweet. I hopefully I can impart a little bit of the wisdom I've learned over the years. I'm definitely have a lot to learn myself still, but I do enjoy sharing what I have learned already.
Well, it is beautiful that you do that. Well, in our day and age that we are right now, in the circumstances that we're facing, in the middle of a pandemic at this recording, I never thought that this question would be so pertinent and would have a different meaning. But today I think it is so, you know, prevalent that we ask it. What brings you joy?
Oh my gosh, you are 100% spot on to say that this has really drilled down to that very question for so many people. For me, just being in this quarantine has made me realize that the thing that brings me the most joy in my life without question is my family. It's the time that I get to spend with my family and my kids. I've always kind of known that they were sort of everything to me, but you really get to see just how much you value something and what's important to you when you kind of have to strip away everything else and just kind of look at what do you have left when we've taken away all of the distractions.
Such a good point, because there are a lot of distractions. Even when we were living that old normal life, we had so much going on. But now that we're confined within four walls, maybe a backyard, I know you're doing some renovation on your backyard, you know, life is a little bit different. And we do look at things with a different keen eye. Well, a lot of people I know are already questioning if you're crazy because you have eight children. Just saying. They're like, come on, woman. Yeah. And this was somewhat sort of, we'll get into it, by choice. But before we dive into that, what was it like for you growing up?
You know, for me growing up, I feel like I had a very positive childhood. I had my struggles like every other child does in different areas, but I had loving parents. My parents were believers, and I feel like that made, you know, such a difference for me growing up having that already. I was kind of shy and definitely struggled with this idea of people pleasing and wanting to make everyone else around me happy. As I kind of grew into the preteen and teen years, that really became a pretty deep thread in my life, was this idea that I needed to do certain things to make people happy and make people like me. And so I kind of struggled with that as I got older. But as far as, you know, my young childhood, I grew up with a sister very close in age, and we were competitive, but we were best friends. And so I feel like I look back on my childhood very fondly.
Oh, that's so beautiful. Well, it's weird and a little strange how girls grow up. You have an older sister and a much younger sister. And when they grow up, they're planning weddings and how many children they're going to have by the time they're like age 5 or 6. I don't get it. Like, I want this Cinderella wedding, Mom. You know, what was your dream for grown-up life?
You know, to be honest, and I did speak about this in the book a little bit, that my sister always knew that she wanted to be a mom, and that's what she wanted to do, and she wanted to be a stay-at-home mom, and she knew that. And I felt very much, honestly, like I didn't really know if I wanted to have kids at all. I felt like maybe I wanted to be a lawyer or, you know, do something, you know, really in my mind, what would make my life different or special or important. I really kind of internalized this belief that to do something important with my life, I would have to do something more than being just a mom, quote. And it was really a false thinking that God really had to sort of tear down for me as I got older. But yeah, I looked at adulthood with a lot of like confusion and sort of false understanding of what it would mean to be a successful, happy adult.
Wow. Well, in growing up, where did you meet God? When did you come to know Christ?
Well, like I mentioned, you know, my parents are believers. And so, you know, it was a regularly, you know, sort of taught and spoken about thing in our home. We actually did not attend church regularly for most of my young childhood. My parents were kind of, I think they'd had some bad experiences and stuff. So they just had kind of shared their faith with us and in a very just sort of practical everyday way. And then when I was probably 10 or 11, we started attending a local church. And through that church, I got plugged into the youth group. And like I said, I'd always sort of had this faith in God and knew about God and Jesus. And we, you know, talked about it all the time, but really taking it on as my own and making it a personal thing for me and not just sort of part of the ethos of our family happened for me when I was about 12 years old. I went to, it was called Acquire the Fire, and it's like a youth conference, and Luis Palau was speaking. I don't know if you know who he is, but it gives me like the warm fuzzies, because our Christian radio station, sometimes he'll do these little 1 minute talking things, you know, as a almost like a commercial type thing, and you'll hear his voice, and he has a very distinctive voice. And so it always makes me, you know, warm and fuzzy on the inside to hear his voice. But he was speaking at this Acquire the Fire event, and that was for me really what made solidified for me my own personal faith. That's when I accepted Jesus into my heart. That was when I sort of took my faith on as my own, and, you know, sort of separate from just what my parents had taught me.
Such a big step at an impressionable age, actually. Well, fast forward a little bit, you get into high school, and I believe, if I remember correctly, you moved around a lot.
Yeah, we did. My dad, people always would ask if my dad was in the military, and I'm like, no, he works in the computer industry. That was sort of when all of that was just kind of growing. And so he would, you know, take different, and my parents were always just sort of very scrappy, trying to make ends meet. So he would take different jobs, and we moved around a ton. But then, yeah, so I ended up in Oregon for high school. And yeah.
Yeah, you ended up there, and you met this kind of, this boy maybe found you first, and I don't know, maybe he had to try to convince you that you two should be together right before you took another leap of a move?
Yes, we actually met when we were 13, and we met at a pizza parlor. Even though we went to the same middle school, we didn't really know each other. Our middle school was divided up into like A hall and B hall, and we were in separate ones, so we didn't know each other, but we had both been at this pizza parlor after school, and he came in with his best friend, and he, you know, the way he tells it is that when he saw me, he just knew and told his friend, that's the girl I'm going to marry. And of course, I was maybe 13 at the time, I believe. And I was just kind of like, I don't know who this kid is. I mean, it was all just, you know, like I said, like a sea of braces and sweaty palms. So I wasn't really looking for a husband at that point. But we did stay friends over the years. And he really, my dad used to always joke that he was like so smooth because he just kind of slowly worked his way in from like the friend circle. And then, yes, eventually he finally sort of confessed his love for me, which really took me completely off guard because we had been such good friends for so long. I just didn't think of it like that. And it really took me some heartfelt prayer and thinking and trying to understand my own feelings to realize that, oh, wow, okay, I can think of this person as somebody more than just a really good friend. And turns out that, you know, really good friends end up making for a really good relationship when you already have that foundation of friendship.
Amen. So true. Well, you guys departed each other a little bit in the college years and then met back up again. But then there was this proposal. I thought that was the sweetest little thing. You have to share that story.
Yeah, it's actually funny. So I really loved, I'm trying to remember the name of the movie. It's an Adam Sandler movie with Drew Barrymore. Oh gosh, it like takes place in the 80s. But anyway, so he comes on the plane and sings her a song on the airplane. And that was just one of my favorite movies. And so when CR had decided to propose to me, his plan was to come on the airplane and propose to me like once my plane landed, because I was coming from North Carolina to Oregon. And so he was like going to get on the plane and propose to me there. But due to different regulations that changed very quickly post 9/11, you couldn't come back onto the plane anymore. And so he met me in the baggage claim, and we were kind of standing there, and I could tell he was a little bit like anxious and nervous. And I was sort of like, what is going on? Like, you know, you won me back. We're back together. I just don't really understand why you're being so anxious. It was making me anxious. And then I started noticing that people were looking around and seemed confused. It was just sort of like this atmosphere of everyone was aware that something was going on, except for me. And I looked at the belt where the bags go around, and there was like a gray box. You know, sometimes they'll put like little items into these gray airport boxes. And so there was one of those going around, and people were looking in it and then like looking around. And I was just like, what is going on? Like, I just want to get out of here. I've been on a 6-hour flight. So I go over to the baggage claim, and I looked into the gray box, and there was a note that said Angela and some flowers. And I was like, wait a minute, that's my name. You know, or yeah, like, so I picked it up and I turned around, and CR was down on one knee and, you know, proposed to me. And it was one of those moments that was like wonderful and felt like embarrassing all at the same time, you know, because everybody now in this whole baggage claim area is looking, trying to figure out who this is for and what's happening. And when they see us over there and he's down on one knee, they're all cheering. And, you know, anyway, so it was kind of that little fairy tale moment. I think that, you know, in life we get a few of those. And that was definitely one for me that felt really special.
What a wonderful fairy tale moment for you. And even when you talk about it, you just light up. And your little heart just pounds a little extra faster. It's so cute.
Yes.
That means you haven't been married long enough, just saying. Just wait, add a few more years. I got a few extra years on you, girl. That will come where you're like, the story gets a little old and then it'll pick back up again. It'll be great.
Yeah.
Well, so you're married now, obviously. You've been married 15 years this year. For a girl who didn't plan on children, you weren't looking that way. Your sister was, but not so much you. You became pregnant. And then you had to begin to embrace the unexpected.
Yes. I pretty much immediately upon finding out I was pregnant, became violently ill. There's really no other way to explain it. And really struggled through a very, very, very difficult pregnancy with something called hyperemesis. And it's sort of just, you know, like the most extreme version of morning sickness you could imagine, although even most doctors don't even classify it as morning sickness because it's just so extreme. And it was incredibly difficult, and it led to other health problems through the end of my pregnancy with kidney stones and, you know, needing a nephrostomy tube, and all of it ended with my daughter being born at 36 weeks. And she was, thank the Lord, healthy. But it was, you know, I hesitate to say traumatic, but there's definitely a lot of scars left from that for sure.
Well, and your heart had to have been bruised. I mean, this was your first child. It's not like you'd had already three or four. This was your first experience. How did you handle it mentally and faithfully with God when you were walking through these medical trials?
You know, I'd love to tell you that, like, I handled it so gracefully and wonderfully. In the moment, it was really hard. And there's a lot of asking the Lord, like, why me? Why did my sister just have a baby and she was glowing and loved every second of it? And I can't get out of bed. I've lost my job. It was really, really difficult. And so there's a lot of questioning. But I feel like, especially I was so young, you know, we got married at 22 or 21, and she was born when I was 22. But I was so young, and it was a lot of time for me to just kind of lean into my faith and really ask myself, what do I really believe about God's goodness and how he's going to show up for me in this time? And it was definitely a faith growing time for me where, you know, I always say that I think a lot of times people like to put God into this box where we're almost scared to push back against him for anything. And I think that God has really taught me through all of these trials that, like, he's our loving father, and he can take it. It's okay. Whatever anger and hurt and sadness and fear we have, like, we can literally just crawl up into his lap as his children and say, Daddy, this hurts. This is hard. And he can take it. And he wants us to come to him like that. So that was really, for me, learning just how deep his love is for us.
Yeah, it is so deep. And you have a phrase that you mention throughout the book. I'm going to let you tell it because I don't want to mispronounce anything, but it has to do with the whisper.
Yes. So I had heard sermons over the years about this phrase called the Kol de Mama Dika, and it means the sound of thin silence in Hebrew. And I'd heard it, you know, preached about this story in the Bible, and I never paid much attention to it or internalized it much until I was older, and in my 20s. And it was just sort of like one day I heard it again. And when I heard it again, it was like this sort of like tapping on my shoulder of God being like, that's it. That's, you know, me sort of realizing like, this is how he speaks to us. He doesn't come to us and speak to us in these, you know, booming loud voices and the parting of the seas and the clouds parting and lightning bolts. Like, he comes to us in these quiet moments when we can really silence everything that's going on around us enough to really hear his voice. I feel like there's so many things that distract us, both in actuality, as in just like actual noise around us, but the busyness and the things in our hearts that keep us anxious and worried. And, you know, if we can just sort of separate from those, for me, that has been when I hear his voice the most clearly.
What wisdom can you share with those who are struggling in search for that silence? I mean, you have 8 children. There is probably not a lot of silence, even when you're sleeping, because that means there are 10 people breathing. And if you have any form of animals, that means there's more breath and oxygen flowing. So where do you find that silence, that time where you can remove yourself from the busyness, both in your heart, what you're carrying, and what is physically in your world around you?
Yeah, I mean, definitely, you know, physically removing myself has been a challenge, but I have learned that there are seasons of life, and depending on where you are in your motherhood journey, the season, giving yourself grace in those seasons when you have little ones and toddlers, to know that this might not be the time to start a 6 a.m. morning routine to get up and drink coffee and you know, Bible journal and things like that. Like, let yourself sleep. One of the biggest things I've learned is that God is in these mundane moments, and that we can talk to Him and we can pray. And I encourage my older daughters too with this so often, is when I'm washing dishes, when I'm folding laundry, like, He's there in all of it. And sometimes we want to separate Him and think that we need a cute coffee mug and a candle and a notebook and some highlighters to really sit down with the Word. But we don't need all that. And He doesn't need us to bring all of that to Him. And so for me, it's truly just been a change of mindset of how can I seek God in those everyday moments, which is truly just to acknowledge them and keep Him at the forefront. But, you know, as my children get older and things change, I do carve out time. I do sometimes stay up late. I do sometimes get up early. You know, I do different things to give me the time that I want for things that I care about investing myself in. It really is just so cyclical and depends on the season of life that you're in. And I think that's what's really hard for moms, is to look at other moms in different stages and think, well, she can do that, and why can't I? And circumstances are just so wildly different for, you know, whether you're working or stay at home, or your spouse works from home or goes to work, or you're a single mom. There's just so many circumstances. But I think that I always like to remind myself that the expectation and where God meets you is the same if you live in the United States or if you live in a, you know, small village hut in Uganda. And so I think of those women wake up every day and they go out and are, you know, working in the garden. The first thing when they wake up, their hands are always working. So they don't have time for this Instagram worthy Bible study moment, but they find it with Him in their work. Just sort of in their hearts and minds as they're going through their day. And so that's what I like to keep with me, is just that it doesn't have to look a certain way.
Oh, I love it. Love it. Absolutely. I mean, just keep preaching it, girl. We could sit on that forever. I talk a lot about talking to God when I'm picking out my lettuce at the grocery store. Sometimes it just hits me now. If I start talking out loud, people begin to look at me strangely. But I have done that because I've had an earpiece in and they can't see it. I have my hair covering. They're like, are you okay? I'm like, I'm all right. It's okay. Have a blessed day. And they're like, this woman's crazy. But that's for a whole nother episode. You all are going to want to pick up your own copy of Love Without Borders, How Bold Faith Opens the Door to Embracing the Unexpected. Well, you share, Angela, so many amazing stories. I mean, I read your book from front to back. I even read the acknowledgments. And amazing. It truly is. And I really encourage people to pick it up. Number one, especially if they're thinking about adoption or even have a thought of fostering, anything around that idea where you want to mentor a child differently, you don't know what that looks like, I would encourage them to definitely pick up this book. Or if you know someone, pick it up and give it. Send it as a gift. I know we're in the times where we can't go always next door, but you can go ahead and pre-order it. Send it as a gift. With all these stories that you share, there's one that stands out, and it's the one that's the walk on the beach and the writing in the sand.
Yes. It's truly, I always say that, you know, people a lot of times, I think, like to write things off as coincidence. They like to say like, oh, that was just a coincidence. I feel like if there's one thing that my story shouts without me having to say it, it's that God is in those details. And he is such a God of details. And we had been started the adoption process and knew that, you know, we were kind of moving forward with everything. And I just really had felt like it was, you know, July, we were going to go to the beach. And I had just really felt like God had given me a name and told me that we were going to have a little girl and her name was going to be Rose. And it literally came to me as just like a fact. You know, it's the only way I can really explain it, was just this knowledge that like this was what was going to happen. And, you know, we had been at the beach as a family, and I just really felt more sure than ever that that was what was in God's plan for us and for our adoption journey. And so we had taken a stick. We were there with our two biological daughters. And we'd taken a stick and written Rose into the sand, and I took a picture of it. And we just kind of held on to that, believing that the child that God was going to bring us was going to be a little girl named Rose. And so imagine my shock and surprise when the child that God brought us was a little boy named Noah, and then another little boy named Jonah. And I kept feeling like over the years since that moment passed, over the years since that trip to the beach and the walk on the beach that night and taking that photo, I just kind of felt like maybe I just misunderstood. Maybe that certainty I felt in my heart was me conjuring that up because I wanted it to be true. You know, we question ourselves. That's just our human nature, is that even though I knew without a shadow of a doubt, I would have bet my life on it that day. As the years pass and it doesn't come to fruition, we start to question whether or not like we really heard God in this promise we felt that he was making to us. And so one day I was scrolling through Facebook, and a girlfriend of mine that worked as sort of an advocate for adoption and specifically for children in China with special needs. I'm scrolling through my Facebook feed and I see this little girl's face, and I'm like, oh my gosh, she is absolutely precious. And her name was Rosie, Rose. And I clicked on it and I just sort of had that, you know, that feeling of, like I talk about in the book, this feeling of belonging, like this something here, you know, and it, like your heart races a little bit more and your hands get a little shaky and you feel like, what's happening here? And so I'd emailed the agency to ask about her. She was this 4-year-old little girl in China who needed a family. She had Down syndrome, and my friend Stephanie was advocating for her. And so I reached out to the agency and just said, like, hey, can you send me any more information? I'd love to know more. And, you know, through a series of events, they sent me her file. And when I opened her file and looked at it, I saw at the top that it said July 30th and 2011. And I thought to myself, well, that's weird. That's my birthday. Like, why is my birthday on the file? Maybe because, you know, I had to fill out paperwork to be able to see her file. So maybe that was just, but then I was like, well, heck, I was not born in 2011. I'm a lot older than that. And so it really just kind of took me a minute. And then all of a sudden, like, it all just clicked for me that that was her birthday. So not only did she and I share a birthday of July 30th, but she was born in July of 2011, which was the same year and month that God had given me this knowledge in my heart that I had a daughter named Rose. And so she was born thousands of miles away that very month, that God was telling me, you have a daughter named Rose coming. And I didn't, obviously wasn't able to connect those dots until so many years later, but, it's just one of my favorite parts of the way that he, just is such a God of details.
He is such a God of details. And what beautiful, I mean, it's a beautiful way to show you love without borders. We put God in a box. We say he has to work within our limitations or our expectations, but God doesn't work that way. And he has so shown that in how he has blessed your family over and over again. I'm telling you, y'all, you're going to want to pick up your own copy, because we got to give time eventually to Jonah. We've got to give time to Noah. You know, eight children, it'd be like an hour per child. You got 8 hours today, Angela. It would be a long time, but at least you would get kind of a glimpse of them, you know, if we spent just that little bit of time. In fact, even in your book, you give a special paragraph to each one of them at the end, with the exception of the recent addition, which we'll talk about here later. Well, I know adoption is so needed, yet the conversations are so quiet. What do you want people to know about adoption for those who may or may not be considering it? It's kind of floating in their mind, but they're not sure.
Yeah, I think adoption is beautiful, but it's also born from loss. And I think that sometimes in our minds, we sort of paint this almost, you know, Disney fairy tale version of adoption. We all love a good story that has a happy ending. And, you know, when two people find each other, and even, you know, Rose's story, those stories are so beautiful, but there is so much loss and brokenness behind them. And so I think for me, the adoption conversation, and part of the reason that I've wanted to share the way that I have, is because there are so many children who need not just families, but, you know, we need foster parents to step up. We need people to step up and support the foster parents. There are lots of children for whom adoption is not an option, but they don't have a loving family. And so my heart has just been broken for vulnerable children. And I believe that as adults, it's really our responsibility and we should want to, and a command from God, just to be honest, that we need to be stepping in and showing up and helping these children in whatever ways we can. It doesn't have to be adoption. If God has placed adoption on your heart, that makes me so happy. And I, you know, there's more than enough resources out there these days to help with that. But there's so many other ways too. And I think that's something that's become really important for me to share, because I think there's a lot of people who, they hear these stories and they hear these things and they think that's, you know, that's beautiful. It's not possible for me, for whatever reason. There's a myriad of reasons for which people can't adopt. But there are still so many ways to care for vulnerable children. And I think that's really what my heart's been burdened for, is figuring out how we as a society, and specifically as Christians, can, you know, sort of obey this command from God to care for the orphan and the widow. And what does that look like? How can we all walk that out? Because the reality is children specifically, you know, in this vulnerable community can do nothing to change their own circumstance, can do nothing to help themselves. They can't advocate for themselves. They can't hold rallies and protests. They can't do anything to change their lot in life. It's really up to adults around them to step in and do something to help them.
So, so good. Well, I know we're going to have information on how people can reach out to you and to connect with you, but such wise words. And we don't take time. I think we get stuck in our busyness. We get stuck in our own boxes, because we put ourselves in that. Our mind likes to be, you know, have us in all these different habits. We compartmentalize everything. It makes us feel comfortable. Where, you know, God, you're talking about how bold faith opens the door. How do you handle that bold faith when God's knocking on your heart?
You know, in the beginning, I think I handled it with a lot of like fear, like, okay, wait a minute, calm down. Like, what are you asking me to do here? This feels like a little crazy, especially as you look at our life and our family. You know, I've said this before, but you can just sort of look at us and think, well, this seems really random. They have kids adopted from all over the world. They've done an embryo adoption. They have biological. This seems random. But I can assure you there's literally nothing random in our story. It's all been sort of orchestrated by God. And it's by me just saying, listen, God does not ever, I can't think of a circumstance in my life where he's ever laid out the plan for me and been like, okay, I'm going to ask you to do this and here's how it's going to go. He doesn't do that. He just says, I've opened a door and I need you to walk through it. And we have to learn to trust him. And I do think it's a little bit like a muscle. The more we use it, the easier it becomes. So we have to learn to trust him. And when we see those open doors that he puts in front of us and says, come on, you know, we've got to be willing to say, okay, Lord, I love you. I trust you. I will walk through that door, even though I have no idea what's on the other side or where we're going to end up, because it's never once for me ended up where I thought it was going to when I first, you know, went that direction.
Yeah, bold faith for sure. I always say, expect the unexpected. That's where God works. That's where he moves. Mm-hmm. And he loves to challenge us, but we have to be willing to accept that challenge. And as you say, that thin silence where we find God, are we willing to walk through that? So, so beautiful. Well, throughout each adoption, I know because I read the book. And so, you know, when people read the book too and they get their own copy, you had struggles. It wasn't like easy peasy. You didn't just call your friend up and say, hey, I'm looking for a baby. Would you put it on my front door? The stork didn't visit you that way. It didn't come easy. There were times that, you know, you got the call and then it didn't happen. We won't share that story. People need to read about it. I was crying. I was mad at times when I read some of your stuff. And then I was happy and giggly and I had goosebumps. Through all these roller coasters of emotions, how did you stay grounded in God? And did you ever get mad at him?
Oh my gosh, I definitely got mad at him. And that's, you know, kind of like I said earlier, learning that it's okay. There were lots of moments that I had that I felt like, you led me here, God, and this has made me question what I believe about you. But he can take it. He can take that. And it was really definitely moments where I had to ask myself, what do I really believe, and how do I try to make sense of this? Because the sinful world we live in just sort of leaves us often with less answers and more questions. But God meets us there, and he does, and we just have to kind of keep showing up and asking him to reveal more to us. And I think that he wants to do that. But we need to be sort of in this posture of readiness of like, okay, God, I'm here for what you have to say. Like, I'm ready to hear what you have to say. But man, does he really use different things to sort of break us down in the process? And not necessarily that I think that he intentionally sets out for all of this, but it's sort of that, you know, he can use all of these things, these broken times, these hard times, he can use them all in sort of the threads of our stories.
Well, there's a lot of waiting when it comes to adoption. For the woman, for the family who's waiting for that call that's saying, we have a child for you, what would you tell them?
I would tell them that the waiting is so difficult, but it's so crucial. God uses that waiting time to refine us so much. We want things to happen in a hurry, but if we really allow ourselves to step back and look at it from the other side, the other perspective of the woman who's perhaps carrying this child and the waiting to get to the day where she's going to give birth to that child and then hand them to someone else, she's not looking forward to that day like you are. So I think that remembering that there's so many facets, there's so many sides to all of this, that the beautiful part of adoption and your gain in having a child is someone else's loss. And really having reverence for that, I think, helps us to respect and honor first parents, birth parents, the situations that our kids are coming from, to know that, as much as we want a child and we know how much we're going to love this child, the patience and understanding that, you know, we're not sitting around wishing for someone else to lose a child. So just sort of remembering the full circle of everything, I think, makes it a little bit easier to know that you don't want to rush things. You want to be in the story that God has for you. And any time I've ever tried to press into something or force something, because I want it to happen now, or I want it to happen faster, those things never work out. They just end up causing some other kind of new hurt or pain. And so it's as trite as it is to say that God's timing is perfect, it is. And, like I said, Rose's story was years in the making, and it's so much better when you're on the other side of it, but you've got to learn to find peace in the valleys. You know, it's hard, but there's peace to be found there.
Amen. There's definitely peace to be found in those valleys. Well, for those who've never thought about adoption, but because of your story, they're now curious. Maybe they have already had, some losses, some brokenness in what they have tried with fertility and having their own. Where would you tell them to begin?
I would say definitely to, you know, get online and do some research about adoption agencies in your area. I would see if there are any adoption support groups in your area. Oftentimes, they're more than happy to have people who are considering adoption come to their meetings and let them share with you some of the realities. And do your due diligence in learning all sides of the triad of adoption. So don't just look for the information for adoptive parents. Look to see what adoptees are saying. Look to see what birth moms are saying. You know, really, really take the opportunity and the time that you have in this sort of, you know, research phase to educate yourself as much as you can. Because again, I feel like we have all these different media portrayals of adoption and movies and things, and they're most of the time wildly inaccurate to what it's actually like. And I think that, you know, that I'm so thankful that the narrative on adoption has changed in the last 20, 30 years. But, you know, I actually do have a free resource on my website for people where they can get sort of my recommendations, because there's so many things, you know. It's like if you look at it like a flow chart, you've got like domestic and international adoption, foster care, special needs. And I list some of my favorite books and resources from professionals about adoption and, you know, children with trauma backgrounds and all of that. So there's a lot to dive into if you're somebody who enjoys research and enjoys like the knowledge. There's a lot there to be found, but I would definitely say to do your research, get, you know, hit your knees and start praying and asking God to direct your steps as you move forward, because there's just, adoption is something that is so beautiful, but there is a lot of, there's a lot of darkness there too. And there's a lot of, paths that can be not good to go down. So you just want to do your research and make sure that you are, being respectful of, like I said, all players in the triad.
Oh, so good. We will have that link for you all in the show notes and on the website. As a reminder, you'll want to pick up your own copy of Love Without Borders, How Bold Faith Opens the Door to Embracing the Unexpected. Well, Angela, in writing your book, what did God reveal to you as you penned the words to paper?
You know, I think that, again, we look at our stories, you know, sort of from like this 30,000 feet, and you really get this picture of, you know, these things are all happening to you. And in the time as they're happening, you're not even seeing entirely their significance. It's like, you know, okay, I lived through that. Great. Okay. Then this happened. That's good. Okay. God did this. And when you actually, I mean, I would almost encourage everybody to sit down and write your own memoir. Because I think that your children and children's children would love to have it. I think it's a lost art of writing down our stories. Generations before us did it all the time. And I think it gives you a better, and for me, a better perspective of, wow, like just how much God has taken care of me. Just how much, even though I knew it, it's just that extra piece of being able to really see it in like the timeline of your life of like, wow, He was so in every single one of those little details that felt like a nothing at the time. And now I see it in this broader picture. And you really realize the significance of, you know, sort of living your life in the palm of His hand, and how He really just sort of shepherds us through these things.
Oh, I love it. Well, you have a community called This Gathered Nest. And I love it. I've been there, visited it. I would encourage you all to go check it out. And she has, I think, a couple other channels too. But what do you love most about sharing your family on This Gathered Nest?
You know, the community has been incredible. I joke around all the time, like I said, that I'm kind of an old lady on these platforms. But man, you know, we look at the world and we think, you know, you think of the internet and you think of like, sometimes, you know, trolls and internet crazy people and fighting, and people are fighting over politics and they're, you know, and the one thing that God's really shown me through all this is like how He's brought all of these people together from various backgrounds, various religions. You know, everyone does not think the same in this community, but it's been really beautiful to see people come together in that way. That's one of the things that I didn't expect. And I certainly didn't set out and think like, oh, I'm going to make this kind of community happen. But it's been really beautiful. And I think second to that has been seeing people's hearts and minds change towards not just adoption, but really specifically special needs adoption. Our daughter Rosie, she has changed people's hearts and when what they think about Down syndrome and what it's like to have a child with Down syndrome. And for me, knowing that, you know, quite frankly, the abortion rate of babies, you know, diagnosed prenatally with Down syndrome is incredibly high. And I look at her life and I know that these videos exist, these pictures exist. And if one pregnant mama stumbles across those around the, you know, finds out with a prenatal diagnosis, if she sees her life and sees how good it is and how valued and loved she is, and just how perfectly she's made in God's image. For me, getting those emails and messages saying that it changed their hearts and their minds about their child or about adopting a child with special needs, those things have meant the most to me personally.
Oh, so beautiful. And I can tell it just touches your heart. Your heart jumps out when you yeah. speak about it. And with somewhat of a, you know, quiet, just innate motherly thing that like this was meant to be. Yet when you were growing up, you're like, I don't want children. Not interested, really. And now look, you're blessed with eight. How beautiful. Well, you have a mantra. Hard isn't always bad.
Yes, that mantra was born in the dirt and mud of life, you know, of figuring out like, wow, I mean, some days are with eight kids and, you know, working and homeschooling, and it's hard. It's exhausting at times. But we've really, you know, been able to, even through the difficulties of the pregnancies and everything, been able to look back and see, you know, from the other side, that those hard things were really used to shape us and make us better people, and better parents and better spouses to each other. And I just think that we have this idea that if something is hard, it's innately bad. And I just don't believe that that's true. I believe that there's a lot of things that we go through in life that are hard, but they produce just the most beautiful fruit in our lives, and they're worth every ounce of hardness, you know, to get there.
Oh, I love it. Absolutely love it. Well, I know there are people, though, in a hard place right now. They're like, ha, hard isn't always bad. Are you kidding me? You know, they're yelling at us already saying, you can't speak that way. You don't know my circumstances. You don't know the situation I'm sitting in right now. What encouragement would you give them?
I would say, first of all, you're right. I don't know your circumstance. I don't know your situation. We often never do with other people. I think a lot of people are experiencing hardships that we know nothing about. But inevitably, what are our choices? Our choices are to wallow in that hard place and feel sorry for ourselves. And you know, again, this is very circumstantial. I completely understand that. But I also know that choosing gratitude and choosing thankfulness and choosing to engage with our own perspective of life and where we are has changed everything for me. And I think that no matter what you're walking through, perspective and gratitude will change your heart. And the only thing that anger and resentment gives you is just another sour moment in your life. I would rather look back and know that, you know what, that was really freaking hard. Like, man, did that just suck, to be honest. But I'm going to choose a positive attitude because it's the only thing I can control. I can't control the hard things that are happening to me, but I can control how I respond to it.
Well, you talk about in your book how you had this checklist. Got to get married, got to buy a house, got to have children, you know, check, 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 check. But at the same time, you have bold faith. How do you love without borders in your life?
Yeah, I think that that checklist, it really ruled me for a really long time, thinking that that was the only way to be happy, that that was the recipe. And, you know, as I speak about in the book, God really using sort of my Easter morning meltdown to shatter that for me, to recognize that there's this whole world out there of people living life in a different way and finding happiness and fulfillment and, you know, deep contentment in their lives, despite them not checking those boxes. And so for me, it was, you know, God using that to help me see that my own faith and living it boldly would always lead to maybe not a life that looks like everyone else's or a life that checked any boxes or fit within any boxes at all. But the deep contentment that I was searching for was found in accepting that and just owning the fact that, you know, we've sort of, you know, Americanized faith and life and what it should look like in the American dream, and that that's not at all how God views us and our lives. And, you know, kind of taking that step back again to look at it from a larger picture helped me see that I needed to have that bold faith to get me to the life that God had for me. I wasn't going to get there by just trying to fit inside a box and trying to stay within a checklist.
Well, I'm so glad he pushed you out of your comfort zone, girl. I'm just saying, I mean, I'm glad I didn't walk through it, but I'm glad you walked through it and that you had the strength and you're still alive. You're still breathing. The eight children, you know, they haven't taken you yet.
That's right.
The renovation of the backyard might take you before the children take you.
It might.
It might. But I know people are going to want to connect with you. They're going to want to find you.
Yeah, I'm pretty much this gathered nest on YouTube and Instagram. And my husband and I also have recently started a podcast together called Well, That Escalated Quickly. And that's on iTunes as well as YouTube.
Fabulous. Well, we will have all those links in the show notes so you all can go check it out as you pick up also your copy of Love Without Borders, How Bold Faith Opens the Door to Embracing the Unexpected. Well, before I let you go, Angela, because we could be here all day, I would love to talk. I mean, I'm mom of five, yes. So, you know, why not just have a little discussion? But we've got to, you know, respect your time because I'm sure your children are downstairs going, Mom, yelling at the top of their lungs, are you coming down yet? Are you finished? I know I had that every once in a while. Well, the story is called My Strength is My Story. What has your story gifted you?
My story has gifted me the ability to not just see the uniqueness in my own story, but to see the uniqueness in other people's stories. It's really given me this sort of fresh set of eyes to look around me and appreciate more of the diversity and uniqueness in the way that God writes our stories, then I don't look for sameness anymore. I don't need people to live like me, do the same things I do, walk out their faith the same way that I do mine. I really think that it's given me the eyes to see the beauty and the uniqueness of each person's story and not just my own.
You're an absolute beautiful gem, and I know you're an incredible mom, and I would guess CR kind of still loves you because he's still hanging with you.
So with tolerates me.
He tolerates you a little bit, but I wish you all the best and continue loving without borders. Who knows? Will there be a number 9?
I plead the fifth.
I plead the fifth. There you go. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you. I appreciate it so much. It was so fun to hang out with you.
Feeling inspired, ready to train for life, and love your journey? Visit createyournow.com for more incredible resources to help you along the way. We'll see you next time on Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie. And remember, always be sure you consult your physician before beginning any health and fitness plan.